The webinar will begin shortly. Please remain on the line.
Piyush sir, Tarun sir, please mute your mics. And Manish ji, please. Monish sir, you're there? requesting you to please turn on your webcam.
Right.
We are starting, sir. Please mute yourself with the commercial. Good afternoon, namaskar, hello, and welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Monica Bachchan. I'm a founder of Metalogic Projects Management Services. It is a maximum women staff organization. Today, on 8th of October 2021, we are presenting you a webinar on Metallurgical Coke for Indian Steel, sponsored by Tata Steel Limited and our webinar partner, Central Coal Fields, a subsidiary company of Coal India Limited. This is our 39th webinar during COVID-19 pandemic. I hope you have gained an insight from our last webinar on green DRI fuel and feed, which was held on 23rd of September. The recording of that webinar is available on our Metalogic YouTube channel. Please do not miss to subscribe. And the report of that webinar is available on mymetalogic.com with a subscription of only 500 rupees per month. Viewers, I'd like to make a mention that the Metalogic has come up with a new portal, which is mymetalogic.com. All webinars have been documented and converted into a report format, which you can easily find it on mymetalogic.com. This program is currently live on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/metalogicpms. If you're facing any difficulty watching this program on GoToWebinar platform, you can watch this program on YouTube as well. Viewers, we have one announcement that Metalogic Projects Management Services is an official marketing partner to an upcoming book on metallurgical coke making in India 2021, written by Mr. Tarun Chatterjee. The book launch will be done on 20th of October 2021 at India International Center, New Delhi. The book is costing only 3,000 rupees. For pre-orders, you can contact Metalogic team, Priyanka, Yasmin, Bushra, or me to place an order. Just a short housekeeping before we get started. If you have any questions during the panel discussion, please type them into the question box of GoToWebinar control panel. I'll bring them up during the presentation, and we will also have time for questions at the end. Always mention your company name and organization which you're representing, and who would you like to address your question to. We will also be having few audience poll for which our audience waits. And please watch the program very carefully until the end and make your votes. Before we start, I would like to give a brief about the session. Coke was first used in England during the early 1640s for drying malt. Many unsuccessful attempts at its use in metal smelting took place during the later half of the 17th century. But it was only in 1709 when Abraham became the lone pioneer of iron ore smelting with coke. Today, metallurgical coke is an important raw material for pig iron production in the blast furnace. Thousands of tons of metallurgical coke are produced due to carbonization of coal in coke ovens due to the huge demand of the steel industry. Then byproducts in the process are coke oven gas and gas tar, which are also being used by the industry. With this, I leave the floor to the esteemed panelists. Today, our expert panelists are Mr. Piyush Kumar, Director Technical, Ministry of Coal; Mr. Puneet Jagatramka, Senior Vice President, OPEX and Bulk Material Procurement at JSW Steel Limited. Mr. Tarun Chatterjee, author of Metallurgical Coke Making in India 2021. Dr. Jayant K. Moitra, Director, EMRTC Consultants Private Limited. Mr. Manish Mishra, General Manager at Tata Steel Limited. Mr. Vasudev Pamnani, General Manager, Retail Sales Development at Iman Resources, and I'm your moderator. To start with, I would like to welcome Mr. Piyush Kumar, Director, Technical Ministry of Steel, to please open the session and set the theme of the program. So over to you, requesting you to please unmute yourself.
Good afternoon. Hi, this is Piyush Kumar. I think I'm audible to all. Monica, initially, I would like to thank you for inviting me on such an important topic of metallurgical coke. And see, at the time when a lot of crisis is there because of the price rise of imported coal, you all may be aware that coking coal is one of the important constituents for blast furnace route of making steel. And for the infrastructure, steel plays an important role. The coking coal, which is required for blast furnace route, mostly imported in India. About 52 million tons is being imported, and it is around 3 to 5 million tons is being produced in India, the vast domestic coking coal. So we had launched a mission at Ministry of Coal to under Atmanirbhar Bharat to ensure that the maximum coking coal, which can be blended for coke making, can be produced in India. See, at present, SAIL and Tata Steel are blending the domestic wash coking coal with the imported coal for making coke. But we feel so that the, all the steel manufacturers who are in the blast furnace route will be taken care of. And by 2030, the government, the steel ministry has planned 300 million ton. And out of that, around 180 is supposed to be from blast furnace route. So we had assumed that about 120 to 150 million ton of coking coal will have to be produced, which will be with 33% of yield. It is going to give you wash coking coal in the range of 40 million ton to 60-70 million ton. That will be required for blending from 25% to 35% in the mix for making coke. So this is the important topic. I feel so, because in the steel making, there are three routes. Blast furnace is considered to be more generating CO2. We have gas-based DRIs and also syngas-based hydrogen economy for steel making. I am working on those aspects also, but for this seminar session, I must say that we have experts. We have author also the book for this. I think all the participants are going to be benefited with this. We have Mr. Manish Mishra also, General Manager Tata Steel, who is actually producing steel. So I hope so that this will be beneficial to all. I will be available. I may be traveling after 30 minutes. So I will be available listening to you. You may not see my face, but I will be there and I will be responding to the questions which you are going to ask. Thank you, Monica.
Thank you so much. Viewers, I'd like to share that there will be a two part of the sessions. Just give me a moment. Are you able to see the screen? Okay, so there will be a two part of the session. The first part is we will be talking from the industry perspective, where we will be discussing demand, supply, price, and availability, scope of commercial plants in India, major exporting and importing countries. Then in the second part, we will be discussing environment and technology from the point of view. The points will be discussed on byproduct waste recovery, technology selection, environment clearance process, met coke, pet coke, coking coal, and future of met coke. So there will be a two major part, and then we will have open house. And before I start the panel discussion, I would like to raise our first poll question to our audience. Audience, please be active. The poll question is on your screen and start voting. The question is, What is the ratio of imports to domestic supply of met coke used in the steel industry in India? You have three options: 50% domestic, 50% import, or 60% domestic or 40% import, or reverse, 40% domestic and 60% imports. What is the ratio of imports to domestic supply of met coke used in the steel industry in India? Please answer very, very quickly. People watching on YouTube can post their answers in the comment section. And people who are watching it on GoToWebinar can vote. What is the ratio of imports of domestic supply of met coke used in the steel industry in India? 50-50, 60-40, or 40-60? So we have got results. I'm closing the poll. So our majority of the answer goes to 60% domestic and 40% imports. 50% of our audience feel that 60% are used domestic and 40 import. While the second highest is 40-60, where they say 40% are domestic and 60% imported. So we are opening the panel discussion part one, where we'll be having a industry discussion from the perspective of government and industry on met coke availability for steel manufacturers and market, domestic and exports. So I'm raising the first question to our panelist. The question is, what is the current status of met coke demand and supply situation in India? I would like to ask this question from Mr. Puneet first, then I would be seeking comment from Mr. Manish, Mr. Vasudev, and then Dr. J.K. Moitra. Sir, Mr. Puneet, sir, please unmute yourself.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks, Monica. In terms of a demand and supply for the met coke, fortunately, India has been importing and exporting both. So in terms of availability, we as a country are not so starving in terms of availability for the met coke. And people here have a sufficient capacity, including the merchant cookery. So I would say the equal amount of import and export happening, and there is no starving in India in terms of availability for the met coke. Prices are a different dynamics. Depending upon the market demand and supply, prices may change, but product itself is available for making of this steel. So I would say both are very strong. Demand and supply both are going very strong. There was a time, there was a time when the cooking coal, how it is going to be available. During that COVID time, a lot of mines, they were going down in terms of a production capability. But lately we are seeing everybody is back into the similar production level what they were doing in before COVID. And so that's even raw material also is sufficiently available in the form of import now.
Right, sir. Manish, your comments, please. The current status of met coke demand supply situation in India, sir.
Yeah, hi, good afternoon, Monica. So in terms of met coke availability and consumption, if I look at the JPC data, and I'm discounting FY21 data because of COVID, and that's not a normal year. So 75 million tons of steel produced through blast furnace route, requiring about 45 to 50 million tons of met coke. And as Mr. Jagdaramka said, that most of the steel producers have their own coke plants. So integrated steel producers have coke plant, and then therefore the wet coke requirements are met from that, besides 3 to 4 million tons of average imports happening. The larger issue is the coal for manufacturing wet coke. I think that's the central point of discussion, that how do you find ways and means of sourcing coal which will give you coke, which is required for the blast furnace operations, how much is available in India, how much is imported, and the way everything is positioned, because we all know coking coal is a very scarce commodity. And mostly for Indian producers, give and take few million tons, Australia remains the main source of supply, whereas Indian coking coals have got their traditional challenges, both in terms of availability, also in terms of washing capacities, etc. So that is how the scenario is. And as rightly told by Mr. Piyush Kumar, that going forward with our vision of 300 million tons, this is a point to ponder, that how do we meet the requirements of met coke going forward.
Vasudev ji, since you are sourcing met coke, I would like to have your opinion, please. Sir, please unmute yourself.
As mentioned by Mr. Puneet, that availability is not an issue, because India is importing the met coke. India has the merchant cokery unutilized capacity, as well as if demand comes up from a different country, India can export too. So availability is not an issue. But again, as Mr. Manish told us, that a coking coal is the issue, because we are coking coal quality as well as availability domestic is not very much or not good. So we need to import the coking coal. So and as far as demand is concerned, apart from the steel industry, because steel, we have the legend here. So apart from steel industry, demand is there from chemical industry, some carbon, some glass manufacturers. So yes, that is a demand too. And in recent month, in August, India was the net exporter of met coke. So there is a demand coming from outside India too. And this is all because of the pricing. India can export if we get the competitive, a good coal with a competitive rate, India can export the met coke too.
Very well said. Besides steel, we are getting demand from many other places. Moitraji, what is your point of view, sir? Please unmute yourself.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I will like to put it like this, that the few of the steel plants where I am working with, starting from 215 cubic meter blast furnace to as high as 750 cubic meter blast furnace, they are all importing coke for use. And the quality is a very big issue of the imported coal, coke. So I still think in India, the locally available coke is a problem. And most of the steel plants, the small steel plants, they are forced to import coke.
So you're saying locally it is a little difficult, whereas Vasudev ji just mentioned that last month we were the net exporter of coke, right? Okay, so that is a different view. Piyush ji, I'd like to know from you, like you just mentioned that the Ministry of Coal has launched a coking coal mission. Would you like to give us little highlights? What is the mission about and how it is going to benefit steel manufacturers? So,
Monica, I just wanted to clarify. See, coke making is a different process. And for coke making, you require coking coal. So what Vasudevji was telling about is the coke, which is the product coke, they are exporting. But for making the coke, you require coking coal. So what Dr. J.K. Moitra was telling about, the coking coal, which the imported coking coal and the domestic coking coal, the quality varies a lot. And the Indian coking coal is not very suited for the coke making. So what happens, we have a high ash coal. So usually in coke making, the blend percentage, which I was discussing about, roughly 10% route now is sale is using 10% of domestic coking coal and 90% of imported coal, thus making coke. But after making coke, you can export also. So the Tata Steel is using technology, and I think Manish ji will be giving you further brief, that they are blending more coking coal in their mix for production of coke. Regarding the mission document, basically, I am not going into the details of coke making process or steel making. I am just restricting my talk, and the document is about coking coal availability from international market and from domestic supply, so that coke can be produced as per the requirement of the steel sector. So what I was discussing, we had some action plan. Like right now, we have 35 billion ton of coking coal reserve. Out of this, 20 is proven, 15 is not proven. Most of the coking coal is with Coal India Limited, and some of the coking coal blocks is there with Tata and SAIL, and then some we are going for the auction. So our mission document consists of this, have a provisions for exploration, how to explore more coking coal. Then we have a technology input also. Then the stamp charging in blast furnace, so that you can blend up to 35% of domestic coking coal, wash coking coal. Then this covers the washery aspect also, because what Manish was saying, that we have very limited washing capacity. So we are also going ahead with additional washing capacity, about 30 million ton in coal sector, Coal India, and non-Coal India is about also 37 million ton. So about 60 to 67 million ton of washing capacity is going to be set up. So there are certain challenges. We have identified actionable points for various ministries, for Coal India, for non-CIL steel producers. So this mission document is available at our website. And what Tarun sir was saying, I think this is a good document. People should go through it and can think about how to contribute for making Atmanirbhar Bharat, especially in coking coal.
Right, sir. Manish, you like Tarunji? Yes, you like to say something. So just one second.
Points. You have done it. Okay.
Yes.
So you see, the first coke was made not in UK, but it was made in China. It was a domestic requirement to heat their own houses. Now, this was many centuries much ahead of what was done in UK. And very strangely, in the mid of 16th century, it was Abraham Derby, not Abraham alone, Abraham Derby, the metallurgist, he conducted a marriage between blast furnace and coke. Earlier, in a small blast furnace, they were using charcoal. The moment he started using, replaced the charcoal with coke, metallurgical coke, the result was disastrous. Means the marriage had to be abandoned in the first night itself to a divorce, because the fuel rate increased by 17 times. So he did not stop there. He found out what was the reason. The reason was that furnace size was too small, so it could not mix up with the iron ore. So therefore, a lot of experiments were conducted, and later on, the marriage has become very strong. And every day it is going stronger between the blast furnace and the coke. In spite of all complaints the blast furnace people may be making against the quality of the coke, or the coke maker making complaint with the blast furnace, but the marriage is very strong. I agree with what our gentleman Mr. Manish from Tata Steel and Mr. Puneet Jagat Ramka from Jaisalmer. Now, the thing has happened, miracle has happened in 2000, to start with, from 2000 onwards, where in spite of many failures in Tata Steel right from 1980s in their stamp charging unit, they stick to their point and they went on adding only stamp charging. JSW, JSPL, Jindal Stainless Steel and other makers, they went in for stamp charging, which gives an immense benefit that we can cut down our import of the coking coal from Australia or from elsewhere, which are costly, not only costly, but very limited. You are always taken for a ride. So therefore, stamp charging gives you an opportunity to mix with variety of coals, which could be indigenous coal. And
right, sir.
You get the same quality of coke at a much lower cost, conserving your own coking coal, reducing your import burden. The third marriage took place again, mid of 2010, where a non-family, you see, the marriage was again done with Petco, which is not which was not in the same caste of the coal. They come from petroleum source. The pet coke, we have started using it. If you ask me as a technologist, I believe, if we had pitch coke, it would have created a magic. But we are forbidden to make pitch coke. It has been banned. The technology has been banned. It was tried in Bhilai Steel Plant during 1970s, but the Pollution Control Board objected to it because it is highly polluting industry. It has been internationally banned. So as we stand today, that no doubt that today we are in a very comfortable situation, that we have surplus coke and India is very proudly exporting our export by some of the cokeries in Gujarat, merchant cokeries in Gujarat, was there. And it happened. It happened. We are very happy. But remember, coke is there's a cycle. There will be always a disaster. Our family of the coke is today our children, coke making plants, are all of different age group. Unless they are cared properly, unless we maintain them properly, disaster may always happen. I have in my own lifetime seen three disasters since Tata Steel. I have seen disaster in Bhilai Steel. I have myself done disaster in Vizag Steel. That is many disasters. So therefore, we have to prepare ourselves. For all those kinds of eventuality, if we don't prepare, India will have no choice but to import large quantity. It will be the largest importer of met coke.
Wonderful point made, Tarun sir. Manish, you wanted to say something? You were raising your hand?
Yeah, so I think just to extend to what Mr. Piyush Kumar said, that in coal, it is always a blend, because it's not only ash, there are various parameters of coking coal. When you consider coal for making coke, you look at volatile matter, you look at fluidity, you look at certain other parameters. Therefore, you select a basket of coal to make the coke. And of course, India has the inherent problem of limited availability of coking coal. And what Ministry of Coal and Government of India is trying to do under Atmanirbhar Bharat is, to the extent possible, we can have our own sources of coal. Of course, there would be a limit to which we can have domestic coal in the blend, but there is a headroom to which there is a need to work. So that's the point I wanted to make.
Right, sir. So with this, I'm raising the next question.
Okay.
What are the challenges faced by the industry in accessing the raw material for coke making? What are the challenges faced by the industry? We will start with Mr. Puneet, then Mr. Manish, Mr. Vasudev, Mr. Moitra, and Mr. Tarun, you can answer whenever you find it convenient. No problem with this. Puneet, sir.
So, Tarunji, your example of first, second, third marriage was very interesting. And eventually, what I see, India is an entrepreneurial country. You know, everybody would like to enhance the business and cater to the world, maybe, you know, become a factory to the world. The only bottleneck, as rightly highlighted by everyone, was how to, you know, get the input raw material right, and the availability and the constraint, whatever debottlenecking has to be done, whatever government interventions are needed. So stamp charging has been very common now in India, as you said. The pet coke, unfortunately, has been done away with. The usage of pet coke, I don't know. Even if it is with a low sulfur of below 2%, it has been banned, which debottlenecking will help in terms of availability of raw material, and maybe the point what Manish was saying, more blend, you know, options available for making a coke. Then the country-wise, when we look at it, Australia going or done away with China is fine, but China was not a big time importer in any case. They were importing equivalent to what India is importing. And if you remove Mongolia from that, then they were even importing much lesser than what India is importing. So our say into the international market in terms of for making of coke, and the requirement for cooking coal is larger on seaborne trade. I would say as a country, maybe the biggest. Yeah. So somebody was mentioning, as I remember, is that dependency on Australia is one thing. But at the same time, I see that our government is also getting into FTA with Australia, with Canada. So all those things would be, you know, beyond FTA also some kind of a relationship, and the supply and security of raw materials should be looked upon. I'm missing Piyush ji. I think he must be listening to us. And counting on domestic cooking coal alone may not be advisable. That's how it looks like in terms of a yield or in terms of a usability. Somebody is saying 10% in blend, somebody is saying 20% in blend. But that cannot be the game changer, I would say. There is one of a changing element in the whole process. But yes, given a choice, India would like to be a big time exporter, including the merchant cookery. Whenever we talk to them, they seem to be very passionate. Given an opportunity, everybody would like to expand the capacity. The India has a challenge to go up to 300 million ton of steel. So debottlenecking of input raw material for making a met coke is very important, very important. Maybe I stop here and then over to Manish, please.
Yes, Manish ji, over to you.
Yeah, so in terms of challenges, one of course is that availability of coking coal across the globe is very rare. We used to hear that Mozambique was the last one which got discovered, but till now it has not come on stream, and there are various challenges in that area. And therefore, in terms of sovereign stability, in terms of consistent supply, in terms of consistent quality, for India, Australia still remains to be the prime choice or main source of coking coal. Canada, of course, Mr. Chakramka said, all steel producers try to hedge from the vagaries of market, or if something goes wrong in Australia because of some cyclonic events, something, so that disruption has also been seen. But logistically, Canada vis-a-vis Australia always a challenge, and there aren't much option. You can try some coals from somewhere, but ultimately the main source remains with Australia. In India, as we all know, availability of coking coal is an issue. You can surely bring it down. The remainder of the problem remains that if you bring down the ash, what do you do with the byproducts? So if you are mining coking coal in India and washing it, the problem that you have to solve, that what do you do with 50-60% of the byproduct that gets generated through the process? And add to that the logistics. So I'm just referring to one study by Brookings India, which would be known to all the panelists and viewers, that in India, if you price the coal, see the price of the coal, coking coal prices on an average from Coal India is, say, it is 1,000 rupees. 1,000 rupees you spend in logistics, and 1,000 rupees you spend in regulatory bills, or so one third. That is how the scenario is. So landed at steel producers would be three times of that. So therefore, and then when you discount it for quality compared to Australia, etc., this always remains a challenge. So Indian coking coals make sense when the international prices are high, and therefore there is an opportunistic play time and again. So that right. Those are the major challenges in terms of coking coal sourcing.
Vasudevji, what is your point of view on raw material sourcing?
As sourcing is concerned, it means every origin of coal or every end user has their own challenges. So let us start with the domestic. We have, you know, mines somewhere in Jharkhand, but if somebody has the coker in Gujarat or steel plant in the Jaigarh, it is not possible to transport it, whatever at price may be. Even government has given us a huge subsidy, you are going to pay double on a transportation. So that is the logistic. If you come to the Mozambique, again, they have a high ash and the low sea, some kicking properties, which is the missing, or the lower grade, there is a problem. Russia, again, a huge inland coast, so they will not able to compete in the international market. Canada, again, a long voyage time, like Indian buyer if buys, material may get delivered after 45 days or 60 days. So that is a different challenges in the all coal available. In US origin, always be a higher sulfur and the higher VM. So that kind of challenges are there. So everything ultimately depend on the price, because a steel plant or the merchant cokeries, they need to competitive in the international market to sustain their operation. So everything is related to price. In 2018-19, we have seen that Indian user has expanded the portfolio and buying more from Canada, Russia, and USA. But when Chinese put a ban on Australia, we seen again everybody turned on Australian coal. It's simply, it is a price advantage. The same way, if right price, right coal, it is the must.
Moitraji, what is your view on raw material challenges for coke making?
My point will be regarding the sulfur dioxide emissions, because the sulfur content in coke is very important. And Ministry of Environment and the Pollution Control Board, they are looking at it. The steel plant for blast furnace, we have developed the new standards for sulfur dioxide emissions. And unless and until we have a good quality coke having say 0.6% sulfur or less, we will not be able to achieve the emission standards. So that way we have to look into the quality aspects, that if we are going to import coking coal into India, that coking coal should be of a 0.5% or 0.6% sulfur.
Right, sir. We have got one question from Mr. Sahib Dino. He's from Pakistan watching the program currently. He want to know, it's a basic question with anybody can answer. He's saying, may I know what is the ratio of primary and secondary steel making in India? Any of the panelists can reply to this. Mr. Manish or Mr. Puneet, anyone. What is the ratio of primary and secondary steel making?
60-40, 70-30 type of a ratio exist.
70-30. You're saying 70% is the primary and 30% is the secondary.
Yes.
Okay. I'm raising, before I raise another question, I'm raising a poll question. Audience, Tanu, sir.
I just want to add what I was going through the discussion. See, again, I am a man, a Jurassic man, age-old man. The first imported coal was initiated by Mr. Biju Patnaik as a steel minister way back in 1970s. And this was the first trial cargo in 1970s. And incidentally, I was put on the job. I was a young engineer at that time, just joined a few years back with Bilai Steel. So thereafter, we started in a major way imported coal import by SAIL, and Vizag Steel went in for 100% imported coal because they had no choice. The coal washeries which were linked to Vizag Steel even does not exist even today. So in that kind of a situation, the coal availability has been always a very complicated, we are also subject to the price volatility, forex volatility, and all those things. And the price was earlier being dominated by the JSM prices. These days, it's different story. So availability has been always a challenge. And I know we have got experts like Jagat Ramka and Mr. Mishra and so many people, and they will try to solve this problem. We have got the technologies. You have got you're blessed with the technology of the last two decades, which is stamp charging, which was not existing in our country. Those technologies were not available. So therefore, our endeavor should be to widen our basket, try to source from as many known unknown sources, tap those sources. You must also try to use some of the spillages which is occurring in the byproduct plant. It's a coal tar spillage. It is forced to the drain. It is a very good additive for making, particularly for the stamp charging.
So we will come on to the byproducts in the second part of the panel discussion. Sure. Meanwhile, I'm raising the poll question to our audience because they are waiting. So I'll just launch the poll.
Yeah, go ahead.
So audience on your screen, the question is, is there a scope for setting up commercial coke making plants in India? The options are very simple, yes or no. Is there a scope for setting up commercial coke making plants in India? People watching on YouTube, please post your answers in the comment section of YouTube. And people who are watching on GoToWebinar, please vote very, very quickly. Is there a scope for setting up commercial coke making plants in India? I'm closing down the poll now. We have got many people have already voted. Please be very, very quick. So here is the answer on your screen. 80% of our audience feels yes, there is a scope of commercial coke making plant in India, and 20% feels no. The majority is going with the scope of commercial coke making plants. So with this, I'm raising our next question, which even our audience is asking, who are the major manufacturers, importers, and users of met coke in India? We will follow the same sequence, starting with Mr. Puni, then Mr. Manish, yes. Mr. Vasudev, Moitraji, and Tarunji. Yes. Who are the major manufacturers, importers, and users of met coke?
So. Yeah. So primarily, all the primary producers like Tata, SAIL, obviously JSW, and others, BPSL, including ESL, they have their own cokery and they make their own coke. But there are a lot of otherwise also merchant coke is being manufactured in India. People like in Gujarat has been in big talk. So people like Saurashtra is there, Vimla is there, ACL is there in the east side, then Visa is there, Bengal Energy is quite big, and Ismoyer in down south. So there are a lot many merchant cookery as a producers are also there in terms of a making. But when we look at who all would be importing, so I would say in terms of a requirement, it goes into steel, it goes into ferroalloys, it goes into glass making and maybe other chemical industry. And the biggest import what we see are primarily, difficult to name it, but what I read in the import data is AMNS is one, and Mukund, Kalyani, Rasmi, some of the import has been seen in those names. That's all. But majority, the import has not been so significant. I would say someone was saying 3 million ton. I'm not sure if that is the magnitude of import in India. But yes, certainly it is in million ton approximately, or maybe 2 million ton about import would be happening.
Right. Manish, sir.
Yeah, so in addition to the names mentioned, obviously integrated steel producers have their own coke plants. On the eastern side, there is the market is quite fragmented, and there are too many small cokeries which operate depending upon the market condition, and because it is closer to BCCL and CCL. So there are a few of them also work as a conversion agent. If you need coke, they would, you supply coke, they would make it for you and give it to you. So that model is also existing in eastern part of the country.
Conversion model, you're saying. Vasudev ji? Vasudev ji, I can't hear you. Please unmute yourself.
Majorly, all the core steel making plant has their own coke ovens, so they don't need to import. So they are the largest importer of coking coal and manufacturer of met coke. Apart from the steel, that the cokeries in Gujarat, they are the manufacturer of coke. As far as import coke is concerned, the biggest one is the SR, which is like now is ArcelorMittal. They are the major one. Apart from there, all the Kalyani, Mukund, the Punishar has already mentioned the name. But if we go to the precise data, the India imports correctly mentioned like 2.2 to 2.3 million ton. In 2020-21, in current month up to August, India has imported 1.5 million ton of met coke, majorly from Poland. Earlier, it was always with China, but currently it's Poland and Colombia is the largest supplier. So since ArcelorMittal doesn't have their own coke ovens, so they are the major importers, and all the chemical plants in Gujarat, they are buying domestically from the coke merchants. In coke merchant, The biggest plant was the Gujarat NRE, which is closed down, everybody knows. After that, the biggest one is the Saurashtra and BLA. So there are the two major ones in West Coast.
Moitraji, you like to share your inputs? As I can't hear you.
Sorry. If you see the Ministry of Environment's website, they are clearly mentioning the number of environmental clearance applications that are coming in and number of environmental clearance that are being given. So I normally visit that website and find out what is the status in our country regarding the going steel plants and regarding the thermal power plants and regarding the standalone coke ovens. So what I found in the last 2 years, most of the integrated steel plants, they are coming with coke oven for their captive use, but standalone coke ovens, hardly one or two applications have come in. So this is the present status of our country.
Tarun sir, you have a point here? Just 1 second, sir. Yeah.
Other than the steel plants, it's basically traditionally it has been the caustic soda industry and the zinc and lead smelters. Incidentally, these are all located in Gujarat, most of Gujarat and Rajasthan. So I was at some point of time, I was the main supplier from Pfizer to Kota factory for zinc smelter of Hindustan Zinc. Now the name is changed, and also to Tata Chemicals even. And these are the bulk users of the Metco. Then the foundry sector is there, ferroalloy sector is there. So they have their own requirement. Sizes are different. Now, as far as some of the Metco plants are closed, which were capable, 0.4 million ton coke plant is closed in its eastern sector, where I was a joint managing director for 2 years. Durgapur Projects Limited is unfortunately closed. Similarly, Arun Jagat Ramka's plant, in Gujarat, is also closed because of certain reasons. I don't know exactly what the reason. Now, effort should be to revive those plants. We must improve. A Durgapur project was a main source of coke supply to Tata Steel, to JSPL Raigarh unit, to Vizag steel plant in their crisis hours. Such merchant cokery backup is needed not only for the secondary sector, even for the primary sector. So that if any disaster, if anything wrong goes, the merchant cokery should be able to supply the coke. So there is a need to set up more coke plant. India must do that. And the old plants which are lying idle for years should be revived.
Right, sir. Now I will ask very quick questions where I seek a very short answer, and not everybody have to answer it. So I'll start the question. First question is, how much coal required to produce each ton of met coke? Anyone can answer. Maybe Puneet ji, you can answer. How much coal required to produce each ton of met coke?
So it ranges about maybe 1.4 to 1.5 ton of coal. That's what you need to make a 1 ton of a coke. So anything in between 1.4 to 1.5 is
cheaper. If all agrees, then we'll go ahead with the next question.
One point, ma'am.
Sir.
Is that, sir. You see, coal is a costly commodity. Not available in our country. You have to import it. So, therefore, everything depends on how much coal is needed on the pilferage, transit losses, and all those things which happen in the port. We must control it. And I believe today the things are different than what it used to be 20 years back. When I myself have seen in Haldia port, at least thousands of tons being going into the sea with a mild rain.
Right, sir. So I'll move on to the next question. How much met coke required to produce each ton of steel? Manish ji, how much met coke requires to produce each ton of steel?
It would be about 0.65 to 0.7 in that range for every ton of steel.
If anyone wants to add on anything, you can raise your hand. Okay, I'll move on to Dr. Moitra.
In some of the smaller steel plants, we can produce as much as, go as low as 0.5 also, 0.5, 0.51.
per ton of, not steel, per ton of hot metal.
Okay. The third question is, what is the ratio of import to domestic supply of met coke? Vasudevji, what is the ratio of import to domestic supply of met coke?
If we are talking about only met coke, then India is only 10% is imported, otherwise everybody producing their own. So if you are talking about a coal, then only a 10% is the coal and 90% is the imported.
Yes.
Okay. My next question is, who are the major exporting countries of met coke? Now I leave this open to all. Anyone can raise their hand to answer. Yeah, Vasudevji.
Largest one is, like, you know, if you're talking about exporting, is Australia, but if you're talking about the production, is the China. Australia is the largest one. Then you can count on Russia, Canada, US, then Mongolia and Mozambique.
So I think the question was, met coke, not met coal.
Met coke is a, okay, sorry, my mistake. I talked about coal. And met coke exporting is the Colombia, Japan, China.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the Poland. Recently, last 2 years, Poland has come into the export.
Thank you, Tarun sir, for correcting. Because I also heard coke when Vasudevji said
coke.
Sorry,
my mistake.
Okay. Okay, so our next question is, how do they differ in quality, cost and usability when we compare it with the domestic met coke versus imported met coke? So let's talk about quality, then cost and then usability. I will start with you, Puneji, because you're importing a lot of met coke. So a comparison on quality first.
So quality wise, there are not much of a difference between the domestic and the imported one. Depending upon what we need, you can, you know, move your specs. Like some people are using nut coke, some people are using a met coke without nut. So depending upon that, but in domestically also, I would say very compatible and required products are being made. So they are nothing less competitive than import.
Manish ji.
So our sample size would be very small because we largely have always been using our own coke. So just I would say that we would prefer to have our own coke rather than buying coke. So whatever little we did in terms of conversion and others, we always found that our coke qualities were comparatively much better than what we sourced from market. So the sample size is less.
Yeah, Tarun sir.
See, Manish ji, I was born very close to steel town Jamshedpur, and Tata Steel is very fortunate to have Westogaro Jamado, others are not. So therefore, you have a clear advantage over others, and others are struggling and they have to, their coals are not of that quality. So you are in a much comfortable situation compared to JSW or JSPL or SAIL plants or RINL. So even after the coal, I've seen the coal nationalization in front of my eyes, denationalization also I've seen it.
Right, sir.
And I am aware of the brain quality of Tata Steel quite well. You are an excellent company, you are doing very good. You have led the whole country in a technology. You have shown the whole nation that you stick to your stamp charging. Others have followed, but they have taken the technology from other sources. So right, I compliment Tata Steel for this.
Vasudevji, my
closest friend was late Amit Chatterjee. He's not there.
Yeah.
So, Vasudevji, how do you see the quality of imported met coke versus domestically, which is available?
Quality, we can get any type of quality, just we need to ask the supplier. Even in domestic met coke manufacturer, they change their the raw material mix and they produce as per requirement. So, there is not a much difference between what we want and what they provide, actually.
Dr. Moitra.
No comments.
Okay.
I have one more point to add. You see, I'm still a learner, and it is just before pandemic, my maiden visit to Gujarat, and I've seen the Gujarat, some of the companies, and I was very surprised to see that those small, you know, the CFRI design cocovit plants have been upgraded. It is no longer manual operation, they are mechanized. And these plants have also adopted stamp charging. A remarkable achievement, and they are producing a quality of coke of world benchmark. Excellent innovative work has been done in some of the plants in Gujarat, also in Dhanbad.
Right, sir.
You must encourage these merchant companies.
Tarun sir, so I'm raising one or two questions and then we will start the part two on environment and technology. The next question is, Metcoke prices has risen up to over $610 per ton in India. Where do you see the price in next 6 months to 1 year, Puneet ji?
Yeah, so it all, it's a factor of how the cooking coal market is doing. So when we look at the future prices for cooking coal market, it's tapering down as we get into December, November, and further going forward. So there has been a big hype. What we saw 1 year before is about $100 kind of a number for cooking coal, which is today trading at about $380, $390 on a FOB basis. And the future is looking somewhere closer down the line, 1 year, maybe about $200. So we are seeing there will be a downward trend, but how sooner it will happen, we don't know. But as of now, for the this quarter, when we are in December quarter, prices are still very strong on the cooking coal. So eventually and naturally, the met coke prices also will remain strong for this quarter.
Manishi, what is your view on met coke prices?
No, very difficult to predict because what happened in last 2 months was beyond anyone's forecast. If I recall, about a month and a half back, prime hard coking coal was trading about $240. Now it is in excess of $340, $345. So I would not hazard a guess in terms of where the prices would go from here. And we all are seeing a lot of activities around us, so I won't be in a position to comment when and how much it will happen. It's a very difficult proposition to make.
I think Vasudev ji will be able to give us a clear picture since he's importing and exporting. He's involved in all sort of sourcing right now. Vasudev ji.
Just 3 days back, you know, all the whatever we have made the assumption is all going wrong, because 3 days back we were talking about thermal coal, that it will remain same at this level. And only one statement from Mr. Prime Minister Putin, and all thermal coal price crash within a day. So it's difficult to say even for the 24 hours. But again, if you are talking about long term, we need to talk about the average. So coking coal price will remain in an average somewhere around 2 to 220. That is the average. So somewhere you get a $100 cargo, somewhere you got a $300 cargo. But if you talk about a yearly average or so, it is somewhere around 220, 225.
We will move on to the next question. What are the major factors deriving the met coke prices high today? What do you think? What are the major factors, Puneet ji?
It's I would say primarily it's more of a conversion with a margin may fluctuate here and there, but primarily it's a cooking coal price which is driving the pet coal prices in the market. And demand also at the same time is very good, I would say. Barring China, who has been reducing the hot metal production lately, which was doing overall metal production of 100 million ton was the run rate in the month of May. Maybe out of that 85 plus would be the hot metal, BF, and which is slightly softening now. They are running at a 80 minus million ton of a BF. So other than China, I see there is a good demand in rest of the world for cooking coal and met coke both. But at the same time, I am also hopeful. Met coal production is also inching up. We are seeing that 30 million odd capacity would be added or restart or additional expanded capacity would be available as we get into 2022.
Right.
But market is very strong in terms of a demand for steel, coal, coke, everything.
Manishi, what do you think? What are the factors which is deriving the met coke prices high today? And then I'll ask from Vasudevji. For pricing related, I'm asking only to Mr. Puneet, Manish and Vasudevji. And on the technicals, I will come back to Dr. Moitra and Mr. Tarun Chatterjee. Yeah, Manishi.
So to some extent, I would echo the sentiments of Mr. Puneet that it is more of both sides issue, demand as well as supply. There's a lot of pent up demand. And that we have been seeing in most of the commodities. And met coal always, you would say that cyclically, once in a while, the prices shoot up, either something goes wrong with one of the mines in Australia, some environmental issues there, or something. Added to that, if it's strong, and then obviously, the met coal producers are few in numbers, and they have this price setting advantage, so that all that is adding up to the increased prices. But we all hope, all steel producers hope, that with time it will even out and we will see a more stable regime rather than this kind of volatility going forward, because ultimately the demand supply would balance out.
I think this is a period of little bit of instability in prices right now, which we are facing right now. Vasudevji, what is your view? What are the major factors?
I believe, you know, if any price remain high for a long time, it's because only of, you know, paying capacity from the users. So currently, all the commodities, the steel or all the metal or energy market or power, everywhere is the price is firming up. So if steel price is high, producer will be able to pay high price for the raw material. Of course, they want the high profit, but again, their capacity will increase to pay higher price for the raw material. So I believe the entire commodity cycle in the around the world has moved up very strong after the COVID period. So that is also driving a price high. And secondly, some of the geopolitical issue, or we can say the international trade war between two countries, also affect the price a lot. Because when Chinese has put at the ban, Chinese is literally paying $100 premium for the raw material, which is the coal, from the Canada and the US. So that also shows the, you know, paying capacity from the producers.
Right, sir. So we are getting a lot of questions and comments. We have got one comment from Mr. Swapnil Patil on YouTube. He's saying, when we were discussing about the quality is also affected by the transportation. Captive is always better due to less transport and customization. And on this, Mr. G.S. Venkata Subramaniam is saying, quality is found to be deteriorating during the interplant transportation during rail wagons. Lot of coke fraction generation is very common when we discussed about the met coke quality. We have received one question from Mr. Abhishek Kumar. He's asking, why not we are focusing on increasing coal beneficiation plant capacity to cope up with demand quality wise? So anyone can answer and raise your hand. Why not we are focusing on increasing coal beneficiation plants capacity to cope up with demand quality wise?
I think, go ahead.
What I see that Indian coal has the very high ash. So if whatever level you wash, you cannot complete the 100% ash from the coal. It is not possible. You can wash the coal in a certain percentage, you can remove the ash. But what the steel plant want is a different quality. So that is the reason I see, if you increase the coal beneficiation or coal washeries, still you will not able to match the demand from the steel plant.
Demand might not be met, but the point is valid. More washery and the mission document, which has been talked about by Mr. Pius also, should be encouraged as much as possible, and the utilization should be improved. So all the three people, what they are saying is making a valid point. as you transport more the met coke, it deteriorates. That's also true within the plant or even while incoming or outgoing both.
Manish ji.
Yeah, so I think as I was saying earlier that of course there is a challenge of using Indian coals beyond a certain point. Nonetheless, in terms of washing technology, now technology has improved over a period of time. There are newer technologies available. Earlier there was a challenge with washing fine coal, doing fine coal beneficiation. So the reflux classifier, and there are multiple technologies which are available, which definitely can improve the yield. And in terms of, since it is a domestic coal, you would have a proximity. Now in today's context, when we speak about carbon footprint, so movement of material also involves carbon footprint. So if we can use more of our coal, it has got added advantage of reducing your footprint in terms of bringing the coal all the way from Australia and other places. So with available technology of washing, one can certainly increase the domestic coal in the blend for Indian steel producers. And besides washing technology, which is readily available, the larger issue in increasing coking coal production in India, which Coal India, which is the largest producer in India, is again boils down to the basic issue of mining, and it's the struggle is to get land available for mining. So if more land is available, we all have read and we all know that Jharia is sitting on a lot of coking coal, and there is a Jharia action plan to basically unearth that coal which is there, which has got its own challenges. So I won't say that there is no possibility. So with land, with improving logistics, with investing in washing technology, one can find way of using Indian coals. And so obviously there would be a limit to which you can reduce imports, because you cannot, as rightly said by Mr. Vasudev, you cannot eliminate every import. But surely India has got some headroom to use more of its own coal.
We have got a question from Mr. Atul Jhunjhunwala. He is asking, with the increasing coke prices, do you think there will be alternative substitute which the industry will have to adopt? With increasing coke prices, do you think there will be alternative substitute which the industry will adopt? Yeah, Mr. Dr. Moitra.
Steel industry has already started taking steps. One is the pulverized coal injection. Now in pulverized coal injection, they are going as high as 150 kg per ton of hot metal. So this reduces the coke consumption. And then secondly, we are now talking of hydrogen, use of hydrogen as fuel in the blast furnace. So this technology, when it comes, maybe it is coming soon. So that is one thing that will substitute the coke use in the blast furnace.
Anyone else would like to comment?
Recently, I visited the Gujarat and I have seen that new foundries, they have come up with this electric arc furnace. So they are not using much coke in that electric arc furnace, and they require a very small amount of anthracite, but it is very small. It is very small. So they are not using the met coke. So that I have seen in a foundry in Gujarat.
Manish.
So in addition to PCI, which Dr. Moitra said rightly, may not be now, but going forward, there would be a lot of steel recycling happening in India. And like Europe, our component of steel being recycled, once we reach to a higher maturity or in the graph, producers would certainly look at electric arc furnace, and we can see more of recycled steel coming into India. In the meantime, PCI, as he rightly said, is one way of reducing the coke rate in steel plants.
Tarun sir, we have many followers of yours who are appreciating, and they're very happy to see you. So they are sending me a lot of comments on YouTube that thanks, we are very happy you. To see Mr. Tarun Chatterjee on the show. So I'm raising one question, which is from Mr. N.D. Rao. He's asking, what is the installed capacity of coal washeries, coking and non-coking coal? What is the installed capacity of coal washeries, coking and non-coking coal? Please raise your hand. It's an open question. Anyone can answer. Tarun sir, you yeah. like to comment? Tarun sir?
See, right now, I made a report 2-3 years back for Nepal Steel, Sumitomo Metals. And that report was the status of the coal washery in India and what needs to be done. So this report was made while I was in vacation in USA. And I'm again thankful that many of the data I collected from the Ministry of Coal's own information, Coal Controller's report. Now, I don't remember, because my memory is very poor. So I don't remember, but I, with Monica, as can use her good offices and can publish this document in public domain with the permission of Nepal Steel.
Right, I can.
Since I don't know whether Mr. Piyush Kumar is there on the call, so those numbers are made official by Ministry of Coal in its documents, so therefore it is available. I would say for coking coal washing capacities in terms of what is available, what is functional, because one is that what is installed and how much coking coal is actually being put to the washery and used would be in single digit in million tons, so less than 10 million tons I would say, or around about that. And Coal India has come out with a lot of tenders of setting up new washeries, so that those are yet to be conceived and installed. But Ministry and Coal India has quite ambitious plans of setting up coal washeries going forward. But those numbers are there in that document, which is available at the Ministry site or with Ministry of Coal.
Right, sir.
I just recollect Asia's largest coal washery plant was to be set up in Orissa near Talcher, and the much work by the Japanese collaborators. It was much in progress, but something wrong went in between. I think about 50-60% construction was done, but I'm not very up to date. What is the status of this project now? I'll check up and get back to the people who are interested to know.
Sure. Coming on to the next question, what are the major challenges faced by the industry in setting up commercial coke ovens? What are the major challenges faced by the industry in setting up a commercial coke oven? We'll start with Mr. Pune, then Mr. Mishra, Vasanthi, Moitra Ji, and Tarun Ji.
I may not be able to answer, but I don't see any challenge other than the clearances and the staff. I don't see challenges in terms of our technology availability or know-how. It's pretty well common and very widely known and available.
Manishi, have you come across any person who is setting up a commercial coke oven and facing any challenges you'd like to highlight?
No, I won't be able to comment. And of course, yes, it would be subject to the way coke prices move, so that would be one risk that needs to be mitigated.
I think Vasudevji will be able to answer this best because he's been talking to so many people. Vasudevji.
Yeah, I see the major challenge is, you know, finding the customers. Because if every steel mill has their own oven, and let us assume that every steel mill has the sufficient capacity to convert coal into the coke, then steel is the major buyer for coke. Other than the steel, which are the Gujarat-based Nirma or GHCL or Tata or new plant, which is RSPL, Gadi Detergent. For that matter, we have sufficient capacity, installed capacity and production in Gujarat. So we have seen the biggest plant, which is Gujarat NRH, is closed down. It's almost, I can say, roughly 1 million tons they can produce. a coke, but they are not producing. Maybe whatever may be the reason, but today nobody is coming forward to buy those. Of course, Vedanta has bought some of the part of it, but nobody is coming forward to revive those plants. A global coke, which was near Jamnagar, it was closed for almost 8-9 months. And recently, because of the export opportunity, somebody went and bought it. So I think major is, you know, the finding the customer for your product. Otherwise, I don't see any issue like land acquisition or technology or clearance. I think now India is becoming far, far better than what we had 10 years back. So I think there is no other challenge.
Dr. Moitra.
Madam, the major challenges that we are facing today for establishing a new coke oven plant, one is environment challenges, because the public hearing is becoming very difficult day by day. Even if you acquire the land, public clearance of public, that is very difficult. And secondly, as somebody told, finding a customer, because customer will always look at the price aspect, and with the strict environmental regulations, our cost will definitely be higher, because China, etc., they are supplying coke with a low cost because they don't have so much strict environmental regulations. Thirdly, is the suppose I put up a non-recovery type coke oven, then I will be generating power out of it. Then where I am going to sell the power? So that is another important thing, because this non-recovery type coke oven is a very clean technology, and you generate power out of it, and some means has to be find out, and if you can sell the power outside. So these are the three challenges I look at. Thank you.
Absolutely. I'm raising one poll question. Audience, please be active now on your screen. The question is usage of met coke being hampered due to changing environment norms? Yes, no, can't say. Is usage of met coke being hampered due to changing environment norms? People watching on YouTube, please post your answers in the comment section. Today, apparently, our YouTube is very active. I'm seeing a lot of comments are being posted by Mr. Tamal, Kanti Das, Mr. Satendra Chadha, Mr. G.V. Venkata Subramaniam, Satendra. So many people are commenting. Siva Kumar. Please post your answers. Is usage of met coke being hampered due to changing environment norms? I'm closing the poll now. The results are on your screen. 55% feels yes, 36% feels no, and 9% says can't say. So 55% majority feels that with the changing environment norms, the usage of met coke is being hampered. Now we will talk about the technology and environment aspect of coke.
Before this session ends, this particular session, I would like to add that you see, many people are setting up the coke oven plant. It is on the way. And particularly, and one good news is that earlier the non-recovery plants were all horizontal design, whether it is Indian design or it is a Chinese design. Now, I understand a new plant is coming up in Hospet with vertical design. So these are the new opportunities. And as far as the power generation is concerned, it's a wonderful opportunity, particularly as you see today, the crisis which we are likely to face very soon, with the thermal power not being available in adequate quantity in our country, huge coal shortage. So this kind of a secondary availability of power source will be great beneficial for.
Right, sir. So coming on to the environment and technology aspect, I would like to raise the question. What are the environment challenges we face with coke, met coke plant or coke oven plant, sir? We will start with Mr. J.K. Moitra this time, sir. Environment challenges, sir.
The main environmental challenges that we face today is related to the recovery type coke oven plants. So getting a clearance for recovery type coke oven plants, in which what we do is we have the stamp charging and everything, but when we put the coke coal inside, then we get lot of tar and the volatile materials that come out, this we can recover a lot of useful chemicals. But in the process, we generate a lot of wastewater, and this wastewater is very, very difficult to treat. Then in this type of coke oven, we get a lot of leakages. And these leakages, what comes out is carcinogenic in nature. So people are very afraid, the ministry is very afraid, the health officials are very afraid. The benzoapyrene that comes out, and in, when you burn coal, not only benzoapyrene, there are a chain of polyaromatic hydrocarbons that comes out. And these are typical carcinogens, proven carcinogens. So there is a huge amount of fear, not only among the public, but also in the ministry officials. They are not encouraging recovery type coke ovens. Now, the another thing is related to the non-recovery type coke oven. These are very, very clean technology, and in our country is also promoting this technology. In this technology, what happens is we don't recover any chemicals. We burn the volatile matter and generate power by putting a waste heat recovery boiler. And this is a very clean power, you can say. And the only challenges in this is related to the that is the climate pact or the climate policy which we have entered in the we have committed in the Paris Accord. That is the conference of parties. We have committed that we will go for decarbonization. And unfortunately, it is not only the power sector that we are decarbonizing. It is also the use of coal and coke in all the industries. So this will be one of the challenges that we will be facing. But my opinion, the recovery type coke oven, of course, there are huge amount of challenges, particularly from the surrounding people, the effluent discharges, the recipient environment is getting damages, and they are proven carcinogens, and the workers, they are particularly at a great, great risk of suffering from long-term diseases. Secondly, the non-recovery type coke oven we should promote in our country. And these are very good technologies. I have seen some of the non-recovery type coke ovens where you can even have your dinner starting sitting near the ovens, because the ovens actually they burn for 50 to 60 hours. So there you find no leakages, absolutely no leakages, and you can have your dinner or lunch over sitting. So this is my comment.
I would like to ask from Mr. Puneet and Mr. Manish, since you know your plans are there, what sort of environment challenges do you see with regards to these plants? Puneet ji first.
Yes, so I may not be the right person to answer. Maybe okay. I'm new to the
Manish ji, you like to comment?
We all know that Ministry of Environment and Forest came out with a standard with risk related to leakages and other environmental norms. So those are there. And as Mr. Moitra was saying, the technologies are available. And so these flue gases and other things, while there is an environmental challenge, it also gives a lot of opportunities like top recovery turbine, coke oven gases that you use. So I don't see there are challenges, but the way solutions are available, it's not a major problem which steel producers or coke makers can address.
Tarunji, you have spent almost 40-50 years in this area, so you can tell us about the challenges.
I will correct Dr. Moitra that it is not only not recovery plant where you can have a dinner in the operator's cabin. It is also in the recovery plant. Go and visit Tata Steel Kalinganagar. Go and visit Tata Steel Jamshedpur plant. Go and visit JSW, JSPL plant or Jindal Stainless Steel plant. Everywhere you can have dinner and lunch in the operator's cabin. People have invested money. 40 to 50% extra money has been spent only on that to comply with the environmental norms. So it is a very good thing which these companies have done. And there are certain issues which need to be resolved. And I agree fully with Dr. Bhatra has expressed. You see, the paradox in our life is three elements, carbon, hydrogen, and nitrogen. They are all human friendly individually. We take all our food which contains carbon, which is needed in our body. We need, plants need nitrogen as fertilizer, hydrogen we take H2O, pani pita hai. But when they make a unholy marriage, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen becomes HCl, cyanide. That is what happens in COVID. Not only that, they further raise their family and becomes polyaromatic hydrocarbons or benzopyrene, what it says, which fortunately does not go with the coke, it goes with the lipid stream, tar, and all other areas, which creates a havoc.
So such nice examples you're giving, as in it's getting easier for us to understand. So technical yet so easy to, you know, you're explaining. Coming on to the next question we have, Dr. Moitra, you like to say something?
Sir, I wanted to just know, this Tata Steel, they have gone for a dry coke quenching. And this Jindal Stainless also in dry coke quenching, I think. Huh?
Yes, they are going for Jindal dry coke quenching.
So Tata Steel is looking much clearer because of this dry coke quenching. Otherwise, if this such a high steel plant with a wet quenching, this will definitely create a problem. Because of this dry quenching, they are generating a lot of energy, they are getting a lot of carbon credits, and that investment has gone into the leakages. See, sir, in our country, what we have done with the recovery type coke oven is we have allowed certain leakages. That is, some percent of leakages are allowed. So that is what I wanted to raise, that still we have some leakages into this.
The top charging and stamp charging, the difference. You know, stamp charging, the possibility of leakages are much less. In top charging, what happens, there are leakages while you charge from the top. And these are all pressurized situations, pressure ovens. So therefore, the leakages are more in top charging battery, particularly the oven top. This problem is not so much acute in a stamp charge battery. And as far as the non-recovery, it works on, you know, suction phenomena. So therefore, the gold leakages rarely occurs. Now, coming to the other question, what you said is a dry quenching. Now, you see, incidentally, again, a little bit of background I must tell the people for their knowledge. In 1997, the first meeting was held in the Central Pollution Control Board, where Dr. B. Sungupta was the secretary. And a decision had to be taken regarding the dry quenching plant. And though it was not a very pleasant decision for many industries, including SAIL, Tata Steel. CPCB issued a gazette notification on the following day that dry quenching is mandatory for any new coke oven project. Today, everybody realizes the importance of dry quenching, and it not only improves the quality of the coke, it generates energy, picks up the energy from the wasted coke. So it is and it's a clean coke. So therefore, dry quenching is a must for the recovery plants. It is absolutely a must.
Right, sir. Sir, the session, we will be finishing in next 10 minutes. So Manishji and Puniji, if you can stay for just 10 minutes more, then we will just conclude it. The time is almost up. We are at 4:27 p.m. So if we can just spare 10 more minutes, we will just take one or two questions, and then I would request Mr. Tarun Chatterjee to conclude the session.
All right.
So I would like to know one, this is the question which I would like to raise, which, you know, I'm getting from a lot of people. People want to know the comparison of met coke, coke from lignite, and pet coke, which is better for steel making. Is it met coke or coke from lignite or pet coke? Which is the best one for the steel making? Anyone can answer.
I don't know whether you can use lignite for met coke. Because coking coal, which you need, certainly lignite would not fall into that category. So as much as lignite is concerned.
Tarunji, you have any input?
I will say that, you see, as far as the lignite is concerned, lignite is in the family of coking coal. It is a less, you know, the devolatized coal, hence the volatile matter is very high. Lignite forms into bituminous coal, then bituminous to anthracite coke. These are the transformation of coal through millions of years. Now, pet coke is an alien. Pet coke comes from a different source. So we made this marriage of met coke and pet coke in met coal and pet coke. It was a marriage of convenience, at least the economic reasons, that met coke was available in abundance, there was a shortage of coking coal, the price was attractive, so this marriage and the stamp charging technology. All these things helped in this marriage. Now the marriage can end the moment the pet coke price moves ups and downs. Okay. Now, in the case of lignite coal, I have to make little research work because long back, there were coke oven plant which was set up in this country and using Lurgi technology. These are known as low temperature carbonization, LTC plant. One was in Dankuni, the another was in Sindri. So making coke, they're basically meant to make town gas, but the byproduct is the coke.
Tarunji, but I would like to know which one is the best suited. Is it the met coke or coke from lignite or pet coke for steelmaking?
Ultimately, whatever we may discuss from technical angle, the most suitable is the coal, which is price-wise good.
So I understand, but the time is going up.
Everything goes by price. What is the blend price?
Absolutely. So I'm raising one last question, and after that, I would request Tarunji to conclude the session. This question is, on the environment clearance process, I would like to have inputs from Dr. J.K. Moitra. What sort of environment clearance process required when we like to set up met coke plants? And what needs to be taken care?
Yeah. Actually, there is a very clean and clear-cut guidelines by the Ministry of Environment Forest related to setting up of any industry, including coke oven plants, steel plants with captive coke oven plants. And these are very transparent and very clear mechanism is there in our country, and which is very encouraging in my opinion. And first you have to apply for the environmental clearance, online application is there. For that you have to do a lot of documentation. And if you can sincerely do the documentation, then there is no issue. You can get a clearance in as less time as 6 months. But documentation should be very perfect. Secondly, there is a thing called alternate sites and alternate technology. You have to very well prove to the ministry that I have explored all the alternate sites. The minimum alternate sites required is 3 for a standalone coke oven plant. And if you can prove it, second thing about the technology, if you can prove that your recovery type coke oven is better in terms of pollution control, in terms of recovery, in terms of efficiency, in terms of energy conservation, in terms of effluent treatment, then I don't think ministry is going to stop anybody from putting this plant. But definitely there is a edge of the non-recovery type coke oven, which is very easy to prove that these are very clean technologies and with examples also. But the environmental clearance process, once you apply, then there is the thing called terms of reference are issued. Then you have to select a consultant and get the EIA study done. Then there is the thing called public hearing. Once you do the public hearing, you come to the ministry, and within 10 to 15 days, you get the environmental clearance. So the difference in the last 3 years that we are seeing is we spend about 5 days time to get terms of reference. You have to apply for it. And in the next meeting, your case is being taken up and you are issued a terms of reference with which you do a EIA study, do the public hearing and come back to the ministry. If your papers are very clear, if you have done your homework properly, then within 5 to 10 days time, you are going to get the recommendations from the expert appraisal committee. And this another 5 to 6 weeks it takes for the file to travel to the minister and come back, you get the environmental clearance. So technically speaking, you spend about 6 months of time for getting environmental clearance. Very transparent process. Process is totally online. And I want to put a flag here that once you make an application and you load all the papers, anybody in India, any common citizen of our country can open up your application. They can see it. So such is the transparent mechanism of the ministry. So I think this is one of the very good things that has come in the ministry.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Moitra. Tarunji, I would request you to please conclude the session in 4 minutes, sir.
It was very interesting for me to participate in this, and my thanks goes to first Mr. Piyush Kumar from Ministry of Coal, Dr. Jayendra Mitra is, of course, one of the authors, co-author of the book, which is going to be released by Monica. It is her baby. Then Mr. Puneet Jagat Ramka, JSW. I'm so thankful to you. I'm meeting you for the first time. I had the opportunity to visit your plant in Dolby and Torangalu both many years back. And Mr. Manish Mishra from Tata Steel, I'm so thankful to you for the very important inputs you have given. I've got a very big soft corner for Tata Steel. And I visited recently in 2018 and delivered talks to your engineers in both Kalinganagar as well as Jamshedpur unit. And the most wonderful discovery for me is Mr. Vasudev, who is a lone representative from the merchant cokery segment. And at the end of my journey in coke making, where I have worked mostly in the large ISP plants, my focus is the merchant cokery. They never had any support from any institutions. They were all doing it all alone, but they have come up in a big way. I have seen these merchant cokeries in Dhanbad in an inhuman conditions. People pouring duty leke, they used to charge the coal with a dragger, they used to take out the coke. Yet there was a market. But today things are different, things are better. They have adopting new technologies, all innovative technologies. They didn't go to China to have this technology. They have done it here in India. I compliment merchant cokery through this forum. And last but not least, Monica Bachchan is, I've come across Monica Bachchan barely about a month or two back. And the moment I said that I am writing a book on coke making, she said it is my child. And so for the book, which what has been written by me along with 30 co-authors, it is all about, India's glorious chapter, what we have today. We have a wonderful group of experts in the various fields. So we have papers from almost all steel plants, excepting ArcelorMittal. Otherwise, mostly all the steel plants have been covered. And it is Monica's child now. Monica is doing a wonderful job. She has created a platform by which, we generate thousands and ten thousands and millions of data every hour. These data, there's a need to create a warehouse for her. She doesn't have to hire any land in Noida or elsewhere in the country. The warehouse is available in the cloud. You don't have to pay any rent for that. Have the warehouse there. All the international events and conferences, they have turned into only, they're no longer an conference, international conference, whether you call Metcoke Summit of Europe or Metcoke Summit of Pittsburgh, they have become an event. Bring those real conference here in India, hold it in Kalinganagar, hold it elsewhere in Gujarat, hold it in Rajasthan. Monica. You are young, you have got the spirit, we are all there to support you. I'll appeal to the government.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Tarun sir. And of course, this is our secret plan, which is now open. We are planning conferences in various steel plants, which we will announce very shortly, where all we are planning. But since I understand due to pandemic, people cannot come to Delhi and or metropolitan cities. But don't worry, we will come to your plants to hold conferences now. So with this, I would like to end the session. I would like to thank our expert panelists, starting from Mr. Piyush Kumar, Director, Technical Ministry of Steel, Mr. Puneet Jagat Ramkar, Senior Vice President, OPEX and Bulk Material Procurement at JSW Steel, Mr. Tarun Chatterjee, author of Metallurgical Coke Making in India 2021, Dr. G.K. Moitra, Director, EMRTC Consultants Private Limited, Mr. Manish Mishra, General Manager, Tata Steel Limited, and Mr. Vasudev Pamnani, General Manager, Retail Sales Development at Iman Resources. I would like to thank our sponsor, Tata Steel Limited, and our webinar partner, Central Coal Field, a subsidiary company of Coal India Limited. Viewers, a recorded version of this webinar will be available on your YouTube channel. Please do not miss to subscribe to mymetallurgic.com to get recording of this webinar as well as the report at 500 rupees only. all webinars have been documented and converted into reports. This webinar report will be available by next week. We will meet again as soon as we plan a new webinar. Till then, take care and goodbye.
One minute, Monica. Can you display that book for everybody's
view? I will.
The video. Well,
I will. Thank you so much, Mr. Vasudev, Dr. J.K. Moitra, Mr. Puneet, and thank you, Dr.
Thank you.
Tarun Chatterjee.